And now thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ Jesus. Give him praise and glory. Magnify his name, glorify his name. Father, we thank you. Thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ Jesus. Father, we give you glory. In Jesus' precious name, shall we bow our heads as we pray? Pass me not, O gentle Savior,
here I am.
In our lives today, move on everyone's life, impact our lives with the word of God, and change our lives from glory to glory in the precious name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, this morning I submit myself totally and unreservedly unto you. Let it be all of you and none of me this morning. Engrace me to speak as your oracle for the miracles of your people. Cause your word to find free course. And be glorified in everyone's life by many infallible proofs. Do it to the glory and honor of your name. In Jesus' precious name. Give Jesus a big, big clap of your praise. Please get seated. My case is different because I am a redeemer of the Lord. And as a covenant child, what affects others is not permitted to affect me. Congratulations. With Jesus' joy in your heart and with a smile on your face, not with a lemon face, with a smile on your face, prophesy into your neighbor's life. Tell your neighbor you are blessed and highly favored. to another neighbor, you are blessed and highly favored. Now give it to yourself, I am blessed and I am highly favored. So shall it be for you in Jesus' precious name. Let me show you what to expect from God this week. This is the prophetic focus and direction for the week. In Psalms 91 verse 15, Psalms 91 verse 15, he shall call upon me and I will answer him. That shall be you this week. I didn't hear your believing amen. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble and I will deliver him. And I will honor him. In Isaiah chapter 58 verse 9, the Bible says, remember, in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every matter is established. So Isaiah chapter 58 verse 9, the word of God says, then shall thou call, and what will happen? The Lord shall answer. Thou shalt cry, and he shall say, here I am. This week, God will give you something to show for all to see as a testimony of answered prayers. In the precious name of Jesus. In response to your call, God will answer and give you something to show for all to see as a testimony of answered prayers. Just as he did for Hannah in 1 Samuel chapter 1 and verse 27. 1 Samuel chapter 1 verse 27. Hannah said, for this child, she was pointing at the child, this child, for this child I prayed and the Lord had given me my petition which I asked of him. Therefore, this week is declared as your week of testimonies of answered prayers. Your week of testimonies of answers in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Expect it beginning from today and all through the week. Keep declaring it over your life. Don't just declare it. Declare it with conviction, because it is declaration with conviction that secures divine confirmation. It is our week of testimonies of answered prayers. Praise God. We are in our season of operation, prayer for life. And in our prayer service tomorrow, 1 hour with Jesus, this is what we shall be looking at. In 2 Chronicles chapter 22 and verse 9. 2 Chronicles 22 verse 9. Very quickly, studio. And he sought Ahaziah. And they caught him, and for he was hid in Samaria. And brought him to Jehu. And when they had slain him, they buried him. Because said they, he is the son of Jehoshaphat, who sought the Lord with all his heart. So, the house of Ahaziah had no power to keep still the kingdom. The kingdom slipped from the house of Ahaziah. They lost the kingdom. Why? Because they lacked the power to keep the kingdom. Listen very carefully. It is one thing to obtain something. It is another thing to retain it. There is the power to obtain. There is also the power to retain. Many have lost they have lost easily to the devil what they have painfully obtained, because they lack the power to retain what they have obtained. There are people that nothing stays in their hand and in their lives. Why? Because the power to retain is lacking in their lives. Therefore, from today, you will no longer lose any blessing from the Lord in your life. So we'll be looking at the topic, power to obtain and retain. Power to obtain and retain. Not just to obtain and lose it, but to obtain it and retain it. Please don't miss it for any reason. In Jesus' precious name. Today is our encounter with Destiny service. It is also our end of month Thanksgiving / dedication service. And the teaching series for all our Sunday services this month has been captioned, Unveiling Your Glorious Destiny in Life. Unveiling Your Glorious Destiny in Life. We'll be looking at part 5B in this second service. Redemption is the repositioning of the redeemed to a position of authority above principalities and powers that humanity contend with. Let me say that again because I want you to get this. Redemption is the repositioning of the redeemed to a position of authority above principalities and powers that humanity contend with. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 6, Ephesians chapter 1 from verse 20 to verse 22. He said, He has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That is what redemption has done to the redeemed. Redemption is the repositioning of the redeemed to a position of authority far above principalities and powers that humanity is confronted with. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? In Ephesians chapter 1, from verse 20, the Bible said, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him up. Remember, we are raised with him. When he raised him up from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. Verse 22. And had put how many things? All things under his feet, and by extension, under your feet and my feet, because we are seated with him. So please understand that all things, not some things, are under your feet by redemption. All things, not some things, are under your feet by redemption. Therefore, every child of God is redeemed to be more than a conqueror. And not to be conquered by what conquer others. You are redeemed to be more than a conqueror over the challenges of life and not to be conquered by the challenges of life. You are redeemed to be more than a conqueror over the challenges of life and not to be conquered by the challenges of life. Romans chapter 8 from verse 30 to verse 37. Romans chapter 8 from verse 30. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? The answer is nobody, sir. No matter who that person is. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? The answer is nobody. It is God that justified us. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that dieth, yea, rather, that is risen again. Who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Verse 36. As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Verse 37. Nay, in all these things, everything in life, sir, every challenge of life, in all these things, we are what? More than conquerors through him that love us. So you are redeemed to be more than a conqueror over the challenges of life and not to be conquered by the challenges of life. This is very important. You are redeemed to live a life of conquest as you go from conquering to conquering. Revelation chapter 6 verse 2. You are redeemed to live a life of conquest as you go from conquering to conquering. The Bible said in Revelation 6 2, and I saw and behold a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him. And he went forth doing what? Conquering and to conquer. That is what you are redeemed for. You are redeemed to live the life of conquest as you go from conquering to conquering, just like Jesus Christ, the Redeemer. Please hear this. Life is full of challenges, but every challenge of life is conquerable when confronted. Is somebody following what I'm saying? Life is full of challenges. There's no denying that fact. But every challenge of life is conquerable when confronted. This is very important. The question, therefore, is, what does it take to live as more than a conqueror in this world? Let's look at the biblical keys to living as more than a conqueror in this world. Number one, be courageous and confident of victory over the challenges of life. Be courageous and confident of victory over the challenges of life. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 35. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 35. Not verse 35, please. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 35. He said, cast not away therefore your confidence, which had great recompense of reward. Cast not therefore away your confidence. Sir, the courageous and confident will always have their desired evidence as the positive outcome that they look forward to in every battle of life. It takes confidence to obtain your desired evidence at the end. The courageous and confident confront what the coward runs away from. The courageous and confident confronts what the coward runs away from. And it is important to understand, there is nothing you can conquer if you don't confront. There is nothing you can conquer if you don't confront it. Cowards run away from what the courageous and confident confront. Let me give you an example. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, from verse 4 to verse 11. 1 Samuel chapter 17, from verse 4 to verse 11. And there went out a champion out of the camp of the Philistines, a champion. He had a record of victories in the battles of life. His name was Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. That's about 9 feet. 6 cubits and a span is about 9 feet. Do you know 9 feet? I am 6 feet tall. So add 3 feet to my height. That's 9 feet. I am 6 feet now. So just look at me. This is 6 feet. So you now add 3 feet to my height. Then you have an understanding of what 9 feet person looks like. Are you hearing me, sir? Goliath was 9 feet. Look at how the Bible describes Goliath. Verse 5. And he had an helmet of brass upon his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of the coat that he wore to battle was 5,000 shekel of brass. That's like 39 kg, the weight of one bag of cement. 39 kg is the weight of one bag of cement. That, can you imagine somebody wearing coat that is as heavy as one bag of cement? That will tell you the size of the man. Do you know one bag of cement? There are some people here, if they put one bag of cement in on their head for 30 minutes, they will collapse. 30 minutes is even too long. That's they just put, but this man was wearing it. The weight of the coat of mail that he wore to battle was 39 kg. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? Look at the next verse, verse 6. And he had greaves of brass to add to the weight. He had greaves of brass upon his legs and target of brass between his shoulders. And the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam. And his spear's head weighed 600 shekels. That's the spear he carried. 600 shekels of iron. And one bearing his shield went before him. That the work of that person in the battle was just to carry the shield of Goliath and be in the front of Goliath with Goliath's shield. That's his work in the battle. He was a man of intimidating size and stature. Is somebody following what I'm saying? He intimidated the entire army of Israel with his enormous size. Gigantic size. And look at what he said. And he stood and cried unto the armies of Israel and said unto them, why are you come out to set your battles in array? Am I not a Philistine, and you servants to Saul? Choose you a man for you, and let him come down to me. If he be able to fight with me and to kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him, and he was a champion in battle from his youth, if I prevail against him and kill him, then shall ye be our servant and serve us. Wow. Everyone in the army of Israel ran into hiding by the sheer size, the intimidating size of Goliath. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? Look at verse 10. Go quickly to verse 10, and then we read to verse 11. And the Philistine said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together. Verse 11. And when Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Everyone was afraid of Goliath until David came on the scene. No one was ready to confront Goliath. They all ran into hiding until David came on the scene. The courageous confront what cowards run from. Is somebody heard what I'm saying? The courageous confront what cowards run from. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 32, David was the only one not afraid of Goliath. And David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine. He was the only one ready to confront Goliath. And what you don't confront, you can't conquer. Is somebody following what I'm saying, sir? To show that he was not afraid of Goliath, he ran towards Goliath. Not that he walked towards Goliath. He ran towards Goliath. He ran to confront Goliath. Not that he walked. He ran to show the level of his confidence. He ran to confront Goliath. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 48 to verse 51. Watch this. And it came to pass when the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, that David hasted and what? And ran towards the army to meet the Philistine. He ran to confront Goliath. He didn't even walk towards Goliath. And David put forth his hand in his bag and took thence a stone and slung it and smote the Philistine in his forehead, that the stone sank into his forehead and he fell upon his face to the earth. Verse 50. And David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and with a stone and smote the Philistine and slew him, but there was no sword in the hand of David. Listen, everyone in the camp of Israel saw Goliath as too big to bring down, but David saw him as too big to miss. It is all a matter of perspective. Are you hearing what I'm saying, sir? Every other person saw Goliath as too big to bring down. When David saw Goliath, he saw his size. He said, there's no way I will miss, no matter how I throw my stone at him. So he saw Goliath as too big to miss. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? Please understand that David did not bring down Goliath by any special weapon, but by his confidence in God. It was his confidence in God that brought down Goliath, not any special weapon in his hand. In fact, the Bible said in verse 46 to verse 47 of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 46 and verse 47. He said, this day will the Lord deliver thee into my hand, and I will smite thee and take thy head from thee, and I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistine this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand. He brought down Goliath by his confidence in God, not by any special weapon in his hand. What does it take to live as more than a conqueror? What does it take to live as more than a conqueror? It takes courage and confidence in confronting the challenges of life. The courageous confront what cowards run from. And what you don't confront, you can't conquer. Praise God. Let me show you another man of courage and confidence who confronted and conquered opposition to possess his possession. Let's look at yet another example of a man of courage and confidence who confronted and conquered opposition to possess his possession. In Numbers chapter 13, verse 30 to verse 31, and then we read also verse 33, we see the life of Caleb. Another man of courage and confidence in God. Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess the land, for we are well able to overcome it. But the men that went up with him said, we be not able. Caleb said, we are well able. The other spies that went to check out the promised land said, we be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which came of the giants. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers. And so were we in their sight. The other 10 spies that went out to check the promised land saw themselves as grasshoppers before the giants in the land. But Joshua and Caleb saw the giants as bread. It's all a matter of perspective. Numbers chapter 14 from verse 6 to verse 9. Numbers chapter 14 from verse 6. And Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, which were of them that searched the land, rent their clothes. And they spake unto all the company of the children of Israel, saying, the land which we pass through to search it is an exceeding good land. If the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into the land and give it to us, a land which floweth with milk and honey. Only rebel not ye against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land. For they are what? They are bread. 10 spies that were sent to check out the land saw themselves as grasshoppers before the giants. 2 out of the 12 saw the giants as bread. It's all a matter of perspective, sir. It's, there are people that are optimistic in life. There are people that are pessimistic in life. The optimist sees negative things in everything, while the pessimist sees positivity in the situations of life. Listen very carefully, God's people. Every obstacle is an opportunity for a miracle. Every obstacle is an opportunity for a miracle. It is an opportunity for God to manifest his power in your favor and give you a desired miracle. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? When you put a glass of cup that is half filled, somebody will see it as half full, another person will see it as half empty. It's all a matter of perspective, and both of them are correct. So if you think you can, you can. If you think you can't, you can't. Paul said, I can do how many things? All things through Christ Jesus that strengthens me. I choose to be optimistic in life. I look at the bright side of life in everything that comes my way. I look at the bright side of life. Listen, the reason why God allows you to face some certain challenges is because he has put in you the capacity and ability to overcome it. God will never allow to come your way what you do not have the ability to overcome. If somebody heard what I'm saying? So those who run away from the challenges of life can never live as more than conquerors in life. What you don't confront, you can't conquer. Challenges are the materials that champions are made for. Is somebody following what I'm saying? This is very important. At 80, as I begin to round up, at the age of 80, Caleb was a mountain taker and giant killer. At the age of 80, he was a mountain taker and giant killer. See what Caleb said at the age of 80 in Joshua chapter 14, from verse 6 to verse 12. Joshua chapter 14, from verse 6 to verse 12. Then the children of Judah came unto Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said unto Joshua, thou knowest the thing that the Lord said unto Moses, the man of God, concerning me and thee in Kadesh Barnea. 40 years old was I when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to espy out the land. And I brought him word again as it was in my heart. Nevertheless, my brethren that went up with me made the heart of the people melt. But I wholly followed the Lord my God. And Moses swore on that day, saying, surely the land whereon thy feet have trodden shall be thine inheritance and thy children's forever, because thou hast wholly followed the Lord my God. Verse 10, and now behold, the Lord had kept me alive, as he said, these 45 years. So he was talking at the age of 85, because he was 40 years old when he went out to spy out the land. Now, God has kept him 45 more years. That's making 85 years. Watch this. He said, and the Lord has kept me alive these 45 years, even since the Lord spake this word unto Moses, while the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness. And now, lo, I am this day 85 years. That's 85. I am this day 85 years old. As yet, I am as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was then, even so is my strength now. Strength for what? Strength for battle, both to go out and to come in. Verse 12. Now therefore give me this mountain. He was a mountain taker at the age of 85. Give me therefore this mountain whereof the Lord spake in that day. For thou hearest in that day how the Anakims, the giants, were there, and that the cities were great and fenced. If so be, the Lord will be with me, and I shall be able to drive them out, as the Lord said. He was a giant killer at 85, a mountain taker. At 85. Is somebody heard what I'm saying? Listen very carefully as I round up. By redemption, you belong to the lineage of giant killers, which is the root of David. Revelation chapter 5 verse 5. By redemption you belong to the lineage of giant killers, which is the root of David. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not, for behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. The lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of who? The root of David. That's your lineage. And David was a giant killer. Everyone connected to the root of David is also a giant killer. 1 Chronicles chapter 20, from verse 4 to verse 8. 1 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 4 to verse 8. The Bible said, and it came to pass after this, that there arose war at Gaza with the Philistines, at which time Sibekai, the Hushathite, slew Shipa, that was of the children of what? Of the giant. And they were subdued. And there was war again with the Philistines. And Elhanan, the son of Jair, slew Lami, the brother of who? Goliath. Who killed Goliath? David. The brother of Goliath the Gittite, whose spear staff was like a weaver's beam. And yet again, there was war at God, where there was a man of great stature, whose fingers and toes were 24. Normal people have 20. This man has 24. He has 26 on each hand, 6 on each foot, 6. And he also was the son of the giant. But when he defied Israel, Jonathan, the son of Shimeah, David's who? David's brother slew him, and you are David's brother. Because you belong to the lineage. Look at it. These were born unto the giants in God, and all of them fell by the hand of David and by the hand of his servant. Sir, you belong to the lineage of giant killers. In your lineage, people don't run away from giants. They kill giants. You know, the children of Israel started seeing giants when they got close to Canaan. Before they got close to Canaan, they were not seeing giants. So listen to me. The sight of giants is a proof of your closeness to your promised land. That you began seeing giants should make you happy, because you are closer to your promised land. Sir, you are closer to your breakthrough than when you first believed. And the battles of life are fiercest when breakthroughs are closest. Stand on your feet with me. Lift up your voice and begin to confess. I am more than a conqueror. I am redeemed to conquer the challenges of life, and not to be conquered by the challenges of life. Open your mouth and begin to decree and declare. I am more than a conqueror. I am redeemed to conquer the challenges of life, and not to be conquered by the challenges of life. I am closer to my breakthrough than when I first believed. The sight of giants is a sign of my closeness to my Canaan. Reka katozo. I will not give up at this point. I am very close to my breakthrough, because the sight of giants is a proof of my closeness to my promised land. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' precious name. There's somebody here under the sound of my voice. This is the word of the Lord to you. You are at the verge of your breakthrough. The reason why the battle is fiercest is because your breakthrough is closest. So you are at the verge of your breakthrough. We are not of them that turn back or give up. We are of them that press the battle to the gates of the enemy. Those who persist, they don't desist when they are confronted with challenges. Because those who desist and refuse to persist cannot possess. your promised land. When you persist, the devil will have no choice but to desist. The devil you resist cannot insist. He will desist. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? Stretch your hand towards the altar. I decree that breakthrough that you believe God for, enter your hand now. There is no Canaan without giants. Therefore, every giant standing between you and your promised land, I decree that they be brought down now. Whatever is an obstacle to your miracle, I command it to give way now. Every mountain is surmountable. Therefore, I command that mountain between you and your breakthrough to give way now. In the name of Jesus, it is done. You are returning next Sunday with your testimony to share on this altar. Now, before we share the goodness, there are people in this service that God brought into this service today to change their lives forever.